Hey folks, this is Cindy. Thanks so much for stopping by. Today's video, we are kicking off a Blog Name Hero Sparkle and Shine Challenge. I will have that challenge linked down below as well as over on my blog for you if you're interested in playing along. We do love to see what you folks come up with, and as always, there are prizes available. In the meantime, I'm going to be sharing a card with you today where I do some Copic coloring and use my Prismacolor colored pencils as well as some ink blending. I am going to be using the Hero Arts Daisy and Bugs Stamp and Cut set. I don't end up using the dies in this. However, I just am over the moon for the entire set. It is totally worth having in your stash, folks. I'm also going to be using the Hero Arts Nested Rectangle Infinity dies, and I'm going to talk about that here as I get started on my card. I have a piece of Nina Solar White cardstock. This is 80 pounds. I have it cut down to 4 1/4 inches by 5 1/2 inches. And I'm using this rectangle die to give myself a frame here. I just need to be able to visualize the size of rectangle I want to be able to mask out when I start doing my ink blending. Now, you could absolutely use a T-ruler. I couldn't find it when I was making this card. It happened to be in a cubby, actually right next to me the entire time, but I couldn't find it, so I pulled this out. I do this quite often, and I do it for a reason. Before I mask, I could use my grid paper. However, I want to be able to get a really good visual of how big my rectangle needs to be before I actually commit to the masking. And you'll see that here in just a second when I place my stamp on my card panel. I want a part of the image to hang outside of the panel, and I want part, the majority of it, to be inside the card panel. So if I can trace that rectangle out first, before I commit to any masking, then I usually get a good idea. And also, I don't want to mask the outside of that flower. I need that daisy to still, I need to still be able to stamp that daisy. So I can't quite commit to the masking anyway. I am using a gray ink. I could not find my Hero Arts soft granite ink, but that would be ideal for that. So I just grabbed a gray ink out of my stash. And I did make sure that I double stamp these. Now, you could definitely use a black ink. I didn't want to do that. I was going for more of a no line coloring. And after I get all this colored in, you're definitely going to get the idea that this was no line. I am using some Simon's Stamp masking paper to mask off the daisy, the stem, and that extra leaf. And now I'm going to be using some 3M Post-it labeling tape to mask off around that rectangle. And I'm going to make sure that that's sealed down pretty good because I'm going to start doing my ink blending. So I'm going to be using Distress inks today. I will have alternatives listed down below as well as over my blog for Hero Arts if you're interested in those. Most of my inks are put away from my move. It just, none of them are in order. So I can't find, most of the time I can't find what I need, but I really love this color combination. So I decided to go with that today. I have Peacock Feathers, Salty Ocean, and Seedless Preserves. And I do have this sped up, folks, because I did spend a little bit of time on this. I'm going to build this color up. I want to go pretty dark overall with it. I am making sure to concentrate that Peacock Feathers down in the lower left hand portion of my card panel and work my way up towards the top of that daisy because I want the majority of that light to be down there in the bottom. I have a really thin, fine stem and leaf right there. And if I make it too dark, that's going to get buried regardless of how I color it. You won't be able to see it. It won't stand out when I finish this card. So I want to make sure that that's pretty light. I then went in with that Salty Ocean, went around the right-hand edge, worked my way up to the top towards the left atop. I did make sure that I blended it in with that Peacock Feathers, but I didn't go over all of the Peacock Feathers. And then I'm concentrating that Seedless Preserves up there in that top right-hand corner, a little bit down towards the right-hand side and across the top towards the left. Again, I'm making sure that I don't cover up all of that Salty Ocean, but I am making sure that as I go in with each layer that I'm getting darker and darker and darker. Now, I know I said we don't want to bury that stem and that leaf, but, and we won't. That Peacock Feathers, even with a heavier coat on it, you'll still be able to see those after I get done coloring them in, and that's perfect. That's exactly what I was going for. Okay, so now I'm going to be adding some Sparkle and Shine to my card panel since this is about Sparkle and Shine. This is a Shimmer Spritz from Imagine Crafts. You could use the Hero Arts white shimmer spray on this. However, I didn't want white. I wanted more of a neutral color because I really want this daisy to stand out. Now, I took this into my shower and gave it a really healthy dose. I made sure that it dripped in a few spots because I wanted that distress ink to react to the spritz, and that's perfect. That's fine. It looks like this is your focal point right now, and that's only because we don't have the daisy colored in. Now, if I were to use a white on the background of this, it would stand out a little bit more, and it would definitely compete with that daisy. So that's why I chose that, and plus that sparkle is just gorgeous in the light. All right, so now we're going to get started on the coloring, and you can see where my ink blending kind of bled outside of my masking there when I sprayed it down with the shimmer spritz. That's fine. I will fix that later. I'm not going to worry about it right now. In the meantime, I'm going to start coloring. So I'm going to start with my stem and my leaves here, and I'm going to be using B34, YG17, YG13, and YG21. I'm going to start mapping out my shadows with this B34. Now, I know that it probably seems kind of strange for some to use a blue to do your shadows when you're using yellow greens. However, just stick with me. If you watch my videos at all, this is probably familiar to you. I've been using this technique quite a bit lately, and what we're doing here is we're using complementary colors to desaturate to get our shadows, as opposed to going progressively darker within the same color family to saturate to go darker. And as I finish this flower off in the stem and the leaves, you're going to see exactly what I'm talking about. I think this is one of the most brilliant ways to really get in there and get that depth and dimension. All right, so after I had everything mapped out with that B34, now I'm coming in with my YG17. Now, this is the darkest out of my yellow-green family that I'm going to be using here. However, I went right over the top of that B34. That got even darker yet. I stretched it out just a wee bit past that B34, and it was a little bit lighter yet. However, it's still darker than that YG13 that I just went in there with, and definitely darker than this YG21 that I'm going to fill in the rest of that white space with. Now, I'm not going to make sure that I leave too large of a highlight. I don't need to, because I am going to be coming in with my colored pencils and adding more highlight in there. Also, there was a split where my mask was earlier and I got some ink blending in there on that stem. I'm not going to worry about that. I can fix that here later. So now I'm going to get started on my daisy here, and I want a yellow daisy. I'd actually played around with different colors of daisies for this card panel, and I settled on the yellow, and I settled on this particular color combination of yellow because of the colors in my black background. I've done a card in the past with this color combination, and I'll link to that down below as well as over on my blog if you're interested in that. And it's kind of interesting because that one was in particular was talking about coloring in a champagne glass. Well, I'm going to use the same exact color combination to color in a daisy, and it turns out perfectly. So what I'm doing now is I'm mapping out my shadows with the BV20, and I'm going in with a really light hand, and it might not be easy to see here on the video, but in real life, these are some pretty fine, thin lines that are illustrated here. So I actually don't have a lot of room to add a bunch of shadow with my Copic marker, and that's where the Prismacolors come in. But we'll talk about that here more in just a moment. So I'm going in with a pretty light hand here. I'm trying to keep those strokes as thin as I possibly can, just using the tip of my marker. And I'm kind of flicking up towards from the center of the daisy out towards the tips of those petals. And then on some of those, I'm coming in from the tip of the petal towards the inside of the daisy. But I'm making sure I'm leaving lots and lots of legitimate white on my image here just yet. After I'm done with that BV20, I'm bringing in that C0, and I'm blending that out. Now, again, I want to make sure that I leave myself lots of white on this, because it goes back to that same principle of desaturating in order to get that shadow. If I add too much BV20 and if I add too much C0, when I start coming in with my Ys, my yellows, it's just going to look like a big grayish yellow flower, and we definitely don't want that. We want to see those variations in color we wouldn't be able to fix it with our colored pencils. So this is kind of important. So I am going to go back in with that BV20 just a tiny bit right down there in the center of that, especially where those petals overlap another petal. And these are really super fine, thin lines. You could probably skip this part if you're worried about adding too much, but as long as you're using the tip of that marker and you have a super light hand, you should be good to go. Now I'm coming in with my Y15. This is going to be the darkest of my yellows, and I'm going to go right over the top of that BV20, right over the top of the C0, and I'm going to extend that out just a little bit past that. Now, again, I'm trying to make sure that I still leave myself a lot of legitimate white on here. I still have the Y11 and the Y00 to go, so I need to make sure that I'm giving myself plenty of legitimate white space to do that with. I'm keeping most of my strokes pretty short, and I am certainly making sure that I'm just using the tip of that marker. Now, this is really key when you have images like this. You can get in there with those markers. You don't always have to rely just on colored pencils. You can get in there with colored markers, but you definitely need to make sure that you're holding that marker straight up and down as much as possible and keeping your hand pretty light. So it's just light enough that you are touching the paper with the tip of the marker, but you're not putting any pressure down. Now I'm coming in with that Y11 and I'm starting to blend out that Y15. I'm not going on some of these petals. I'm not completely going back over that BV20 or the C0. I kind of just barely touch that and then bring it back out. And I don't completely go over all of the Y15 from the tips of those petals towards the center of the daisy. Hopefully that makes sense. I want to keep that variation in that color. The Y11 will lift up quite a bit of that Y15. And I don't want to do that. Even though I'm going to be coming in with colored pencils, I need that base color underneath that to kind of help finish this daisy off. It's kind of like an underpainting, kind of a base coat. It's your first layer of color, and it will show through those colored pencils. So it's super important to make sure that you have that color in there. Now I'm finishing this off with the Y00. I barely went over that Y11, and I certainly didn't go over the BV20, the C0, or the Y15. Okay, so before I bring in my colored pencils here, although I did almost forget, you saw me pick up my colored pencil there, but before I bring in my colored pencils, I need to color in the center of this daisy. Once you have your colored pencils down, you cannot color over the top of them with your Copics. It will ruin them. So you make sure all of your Copic work is done first, folks, no matter what you're coloring. Now I'm going to map this out with the B34. This is the same colors as I used for the leaves and the stem. If I were to do this again, I would probably choose some different greens. It looked great on the leaves and the stem. However, I wasn't a big fan of it here in the middle of this daisy. It was a little too yellow. And with the yellow on this daisy, I felt like it was a little much. At the end of the day, it's fine. I fixed it. However, in hindsight, I would probably do something different. After I had that B34 down, I went in with that YG17, then with the YG13, and then the YG21. And I have the sped up, and I'm sorry, I should have slowed this down because everything that I'm putting down, I'm actually stippling it. I'm not flicking or swishing or anything like that. The whole entire thing is done with stippling because I really want to play up that texture. After I had my Copics down, now I'm bringing in a green fine liner pen. This is more of an olive green. It's pretty dark. And I'm going in where I had that B34, blending it out a little bit into that YG17. And I'm also stippling that in around the center of the daisy where the actual petals are. I want those to kind of bloom out a little bit so they look like they're standing up away from the center of this flower. So they're a legitimate stamen. I went in with another lighter green fine liner pen. Now I'm coming in with a super light green. This is almost a neon-ish, but over the top of those other fine liners and that Copic, it blends in really nicely. It kind of gives it a little bit more of a green tint as opposed to a yellow, although it looks yellow. In real life, it doesn't look that way once I stipple it on there. And I'm just going to go back and forth and kind of work at this. I do want to make sure that I'm leaving myself some highlight there, some definite lighter edges in the center of that daisy, so it looks like it has some depth and dimension in that as well. Okay, so now I'm ready to start bringing in my colored pencils here, and I'm going to be starting with the Prismacolor Blue Violet Lake, and I'm going to start adding this into my deepest, darkest areas where I would have any shadow. So any petal that is over the top of another petal, anything that is moving away from me. This is real time, so you can hopefully see how slow I'm going and how light of a hand I'm using. And it is so light. I am just barely touching the surface of my paper with this pencil. If I need to, I can keep going over the top of it and build it up. If you go in with too heavy a hand with a color like this, it's just going to look like you have this bluish purple pencil over the top of yellow Copic coloring, and it won't look right. So it's super important to make sure that you're going in with a really light hand. This is probably going to be the longest process out of the whole thing, and it's totally worth it. The card itself probably took me about an hour and a half altogether, start to finish. And this was a good majority of it. I do try to show you as much real time as I possibly can, folks. I know that you really like that. But I also needed to be able to get this down in a more manageable video. So definitely make sure that you're going in with a super light hand and just build it up as you go. So we're desaturating in order to get color as opposed to saturating in order to achieve color. We want the eye to look at this and we want it to think that shadow. We don't want it to look at this and think, well, that's just a really dark orange, because that's not necessarily realistic. You can use all sorts of colors to achieve this look, but your complementary colors are generally your best bet. Sometimes making mud is not a bad thing, especially when you're going for something a little bit more realistic. Now, if you don't have a lot of Copics on hand, if you have grays and browns, those will absolutely work. They will. When you add gray to anything, it automatically desaturates. However, it's going to give you a slightly different look than using your color's complementary color. So you do whatever works best for you. I really enjoy this process and I really love how it turns out. So I usually lend more towards that, especially here more lately. Okay, so now I'm coming in with the Prismacolor Mineral Orange. This is the darkest color that would be in this daisy. Now, keep in mind that Blue Violet Lake, that's not our darkest color. It's what we're using to make our darkest color with this mineral orange. So I'm adding this mineral orange straight over the top of everything that I had done with that Blue Violet Lake, and I'm extending it just past that. So you can see a darker shade of mineral orange and the true color of mineral orange over that yellow. Again, I'm going in with a really light hand because I can continue to go over the top of this as much as I need to. And in fact, I do come in later and I go in a little bit heavier, especially where some of those petals are hanging over the top of another petal. I go underneath that and reinforce those lines and that shadow. The other benefit to going in with a super light hand is see these two petals that I'm shading right here with this mineral orange. I put this down. I have a really light hand. I'm thinking, okay, I want some shadow and I want some shade there. I hadn't done any previous work to those before. And I'm coloring along and my eyes keep drifting back up to those two petals. Now, this is probably something only I would notice because it's my card. I'm the one working on it. If I didn't say anything, nobody else would probably be the wiser. But my eyes keep going back up to it and I hate them. I don't like the way they look. So the upside to going in with a super light hand is I know that I'm going to be able to go back to those when I'm ready, and I'm going to be able to erase that mineral orange, and nobody's going to be the wiser for it. I actually end up doing something different with those two petals later, but I could erase that mineral orange, and I could have left them, and nobody would have known. So that's all the more reason to go in with a light hand too, folks. I'm going to continue to build this up until I get it where I want it to. And I'm also using the colored pencils to define the edges of those petals, especially where my ink blending is. And again, I'm going for that no line look, definitely around that ink blending, so everything kind of works well together. So I'm using those colored pencils to define those shapes, and I'm making sure that my pencils stay nice and sharp. So every once in a while, I'll stop coloring when I see that my lines are getting too fat or I'm starting to get too heavy. I will stop what I'm doing and I'll sharpen my pencil. Make sure that I'm keeping those nice and sharp. Now, I erased those mineral orange. Now I'm coming in with that yellow ochre. And now I'm going to add the shadows in with those. I'm just going in really light, kind of building that up till I'm happy with it. I got a little heavy-handed on that one, so I erased it. Now I can come back in and just kind of work at it until I get it where I want it to. At the end of the day, it was really just about where I was putting the shadow as opposed to how heavy it was or what color it was, but it's fine. I worked it out, not a big deal. Again, it's probably only something that I would have noticed anyways. I am also making sure as I'm coloring in with this yellow ochre that I'm not coloring over the top of all of that Copic coloring I did. I don't need to. I am leaving a good majority of that Y00 still visible on my image here. I don't need to completely color over the top of it. I'm just reinforcing the shadows and the movement of this flower, kind of working towards making it look more realistic as opposed to a flat one-dimension image here. And I'll keep going back in and I'll keep going over that until I get it where I want it to. Now, after I had everything colored in, I'm going to bring in my Derwent drawing pencil. This is Chinese white. I am in love with this thing. I cannot get enough of it lately. So I'm going to come in with this pencil and I am just very lightly sketching over the top of my highlight area. It's the same motion as I would use if I was using a Copic and I wanted to flick that color in. I'm keeping my hand super light. I am only going over that highlight portion of it, and I can still see a good bit of that Y00 right underneath it. I don't need to make this solid. It's still going to read as a highlight. It's still going to reinforce it. In fact, you can tell the difference with the ones that I had done as opposed to the ones I haven't. And I'm also going to get down right there in the center of those, and with a super light hand with a white pencil, I'm going to kind of bring that out a little bit on the edges of those petals so they look like they fold in just a wee bit more. So now I'm going to start using the colored pencils on my leaves and stems here. I'm going to be using indigo blue, apple green, and spring green. And it's the same concept that I've used with my flower itself. I'm going to map out those shadows with this indigo blue. Again, super duper light hand. I'll bring in that apple green, go directly over the top of that indigo, and extend that just a little bit beyond it. Super light hand, leaving some of that Copic color to show through. As soon as I'm done with that, I'm bringing in my spring green here. I go over a little bit of that apple green and then a little bit beyond that, but again, leaving Copic. So I also went over that spot where I had done that ink blending on the stem and kind of fixed that a little bit. Now it looks like it's a part of the stem. No harm, no foul. Nobody's going to notice the difference. So I want to reinforce the texture on the center of my flower here. So I have a Sakura clear glaze pen and I am stippling the center of this flower and just a little bit past that. Since this is clear, I can kind of bring this out into the petals of those daisies and it kind of only reinforces the stamen that I had stippled on there that much more. I'm going to let that dry for a minute and then I'm going to bring in my Nuvo Aqua Shimmer pen and I'm just going to go directly over the highlights. I did stamp a sentiment on this. I forgot to film it, but I just put it in my Misty stamping tool, took out the foam, stamped my sentiments on there in Hero Arts, a black dye ink, and called that good. I also used that Derwent drawing pencil and went over the top of those areas that had bled out And then I added a little bit of a drop shadow with one of my gray Prismacolored pencils. Again, super duper light hand. Built that up, built that shadow up to where I wanted it, and then called it good. And that is it, folks. We are done. We are good to go. Again, I will have the blog name Harold Sparkle and Shine Challenge link down below, as well as over on my blog. So definitely go check that out. We love, love, love to see what you have for us. I hope you enjoyed my card today. If you did, hit that like button and share it with your friends. Also, be sure to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. Tap that bell next to the subscribe button so you can receive all future notifications. Thanks again so much for stopping by. Until next time.